Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of CPATrendlines.com, now available on iTunes. CPA Trendlines presents an episode of The Disruptors.
Welcome to Accounting Disruptor Conversations. I'm your host, Liz Farr from CPA Trendlines. My guest today is Bill Penczak, founder and chief insights officer at Mica Ventures. So let's dive in because we have a lot to cover.
Sure, let's go for it.
Okay. Accounting talent in the U.S. has been scarce for years. COVID made it worse. What are some ideas you have on how to make things better?
Sure. So it's I've used this quote before. The problem oftentimes is that many firms have smart people doing stupid work. And so what I mean by that is you think about what it takes to go through college and earn your accounting degree, you know, even more effort that is required to get your CPA. And you get these really, really talented, smart young people, and they go through, let's say on the audit side, they go through years of mindless work that is could be automated, could be offshored, could be something else. And that's one of the reasons why there's such a talent shortage, is because I think the market has figured that out. And I also think that there's a lot of different other options that young people have that isn't public accounting. And it's kind of a shame. I think the other thing to that is, the salaries that are paid to newcomers into the industry, even though they've been rising and even though more firms are paying more, as we saw with the inflation in 2022, it still is below average. So the average college student in 2022 earns about $55,000 a year in their first job. Mm-hmm. So what used to be, I think there's always a perception in the industry that we paid really well, and that may have been the case years ago, but now the average is about $55,000 a year. And by comparison, if you look at kids that are getting out of college today with an engineering degree, for example, it's about $20,000 more per year, about $75,000 a year for starting out. And not to mention, I think there's also been a brain drain over the past decade or more of kids with the same sort of skill set that will go into finance instead of going into accounting. And, you know, they may have to work ungodly hours too if they go work for a private equity firm or whatever else, but the reward is a lot there. And, I think money talks, and I think that's one of the things that that also is an encumbrance for the industry, is that besides doing that tough, mindless, what I call that mindless work, the salary levels are not where they should be. And then I think there's also, and this may be perception, or maybe it's a reality, about that the partners in firms are hoarding all of the profits. And, you know, I've seen a lot of different information from either associations or from the MAP survey or other publications. And so then I'm not even going to cite a number because I've seen it all over the place, but the partner comp is 8-10 times maybe the compensation for a person starting off. And I think there's probably some resentment on the part of younger staff of, why should I be busting my butt at 10 o'clock at night doing cash reconciliation for a client, and the partner's already gone home or to one of their homes in their new Lexus. And again, I'm overstating it a little bit, but I think there's a perception or a reality of that disparity. And then I also think that firms could do a better job of explaining or setting forth a path of what your career path could be, either in public accounting or even at the specific firm. And so, you know, the performance reviews that firms do are usually looking in the past, towards the past, of what did you do, what could you do better. But creating a notion of what your career could be like at a firm, and whether it's moving up to the next level or getting into a consulting role or doing something else besides that kind of cash reconciliation nightmare that you have to go through, would be a better way of getting people to understand that there is life beyond busy season. And I think you get so caught up in working those awful hours that anything that comes up that you could do that's different, whether it's a different firm or a different career, is going to sound appealing when, you know, right, March or April rolls around. So it's a combination. It's the pay levels. It's the lack of technology and the type of work that young people are forced to do. And then maybe that perception of the fact that a disproportionate amount of the monies that firms earn go to the partners and not to the rest of everybody else. So I think those are kind of fundamental issues that some firms are getting better at and others not. I'm familiar with one firm that is going to do a program in 2023 where if there's incremental profit that is tied back to the activities of individuals, the individuals are going to benefit from that in a pretty significant way. So like at the staff level, there could be, you know, bonuses of $10,000 at the extreme end of it, but it's kind of a revenue share. So if the firm does well, mm-hmm, and that individual is responsible for that in terms of what they do or how they're working or how much they're billable, they're going to have an upside to it. So I think that's kind of an innovative way. And I think firms just have to think differently. And the challenge is the most of the people running firms today, whatever system it was in the past, it's worked for them. They got the brass ring. And now, mm-hmm, I think they have to think a little bit differently because, you know, there's been a generational shift in the marketplace. And the things that I, as a person in my 60s, think about and the way that I grew up is going to be different from somebody in their 50s or their 40s or definitely in their 20s or 30s.
I agree with you there. You know, I think you're spot on with the money because there's this perception that, well, you know, the partner is taking home $300,000-$400,000 a year, you know, but yet I'm busting my butt and doing all the work. They're taking all the glory and I'm not earning even a third of that. So why should I do all the work and not get the reward?
Yeah, either the monetary reward or the softer reward of do a job well done or seeing the future or having some sort of, you know, something to look forward to rather than the next audit or the next tax return.
All right. And you also mentioned having a career path, a clear career path within firms. Is that something that some firms are beginning to do more of?
Yeah. Because, it's funny. This is we're recording this the first week of January, and so I'm finishing up the strategic planning sessions for a number of different firms, and probably 2/3 of the firms that I'm working with right now have identified the need to do a better job of either mentoring, which is not the job skills so much, but more the softer skills and the career development that I was describing earlier, or even ramping up the conversations that they're having with people that are not a review and it's not anything formal, but just like spending time with your people and talking to them, for God's sakes. And so that's become predominant. And I think, you know, there's always an ebb and flow. And, you know, the mantra for 22 and carrying into 23 has been all about the people because, you know, as everybody knows, there's not enough people to do the work that we've got right now, the firms have right now. And, you know, so the wisdom has now become, well, maybe we should talk to them and see what they really need. And it's like, that might be a good thing to do. And I don't know. And this is maybe a gross overstatement, but it's like it's the whole left brain, right brain type of thought. And so a typical quote unquote CPA, more left brained, and these kind of softer conversations is more right brained. And it's maybe out of the wheelhouse for a lot of the partners to have those kind of conversations and let their hair down and you know, open themselves up a little bit. So in order to get their people to do the same and have kind of a frank conversation, that's not just here's what you need to do, here's when you need to do it, and by golly, get it done. I think that may be out of the zone. So I think we need a kinder, gentler way that we're approaching people, because it directly drives retention. And you know, people don't leave jobs for money necessarily. They leave it because of the relationship that they have with their boss. I mean, all of the data that I've ever read indicates that. So it's more about the environment and what today is and what tomorrow could bring versus what ends up in their paycheck every 2 weeks. I mean, again, that's a factor. And if I was in my early 20s, going to make 10 grand more than I'm making a firm, that would certainly be interesting. But at the same time, there are other environmental things that firms can do to improve themselves and really stand out from other firms.
I agree with you there. And I've talked to a lot of people who really emphasize creating a good culture where you're really appreciated and where there is just constant communication at all levels. You know, you're not just in this little cubicle cranking out the work, but there are people who really do take an interest in you.
And you know, COVID has made that harder. Because so many people are, so a lot of people are still working at home. And, you know, maybe I'm old fashioned in this regard, but it does make a difference being able to walk down the hallway and bump into people and have a conversation and like, oh yeah, I forgot to tell you about this. And it just, it makes it less transactional. And I think what's happened now over the past almost 3 years now is that a lot of work has become transactional. We want you to go do this and you have to do it by here. And here's what we're going to pay you for. And there's not a whole lot. And, you know, all the virtual happy hours in the world are not going to really fix that. And because no. I think at our essence, humans are social creatures, even shy accountants. And you need and deserve that kind of human interaction. So it's interesting. So I'm not sure if the industry has the capacity to do that. And, you know, if the economy goes south in 2023, and there's a whole lot of speculation about whether that actually will happen or not happen. And let's say that the job market for public accounting leveled itself again, and there wasn't such a demand for people, would we go back to the ways that we've always done it? And that's probably the case. But there's always going to be some outliers, and some firms are going to be better at it and about growing their people, developing their people, communicating with their people. And I think those are the ones that will be continue to be attractive regardless of what's going on in the economy.
I think you're right. And I'm not sure that what the economy does will really impact the talent shortage too much. A while back, I looked back in the archives of the Journal of Accountancy to see how far back I could find articles on the talent shortage. And I went all the way back to 1998, which is as far back as their archives went. And every couple of years, despite what was going on in the economy, there was an article about the war on talent and how it's hard to find people. So this is not something that I think a poor economy will ease in any way.
Yeah, I think you're right. And the other dynamic is, in a macro sense, there are fewer high school students going into college to study public accounting. So you've got that. They're going into engineering or finance or something else. And that trend is going to continue. So, you know, if we think it's bad now, let's take a trajectory and fast forward that for another 4 year cycle of another set of kids going through college. What's it going to look like then? You know, is technology going to save us? I don't know. Are people going to have to work more and do the same thing? Let's hope not.
Yeah, I don't know what the future will hold. But I do know that I've been seeing the business model for accounting change a little bit. You know, a couple weeks ago, I saw Ron Baker talk about the subscription model. I've heard people talking about really different ways of running their firms. What are some of the things that you're seeing?
That's funny you mentioned that, because I literally last Thursday and Friday read Time's Up. The book that Ron Baker wrote about the subscription model, and so your question is very timely. So I think I think two things are happening. There are younger partners coming into the forefront that may be more amenable to looking at different things, different ways of running the business. So, you know, and you can unpack that a couple of different ways. So for the typical middle market firm, typical middle market, like under, say, $15 million or so, the average, I think, if you look at the Inside Public Accounting or the Accounting Today data, the average is about 15% of their revenue is coming from non-compliance work. So not audit, not tax, but compliant, but consulting type work, advisory. And I think that's one trend because it also addresses what we were talking about earlier. It gives another career path for somebody that's got some good skills. So whether it's doing ESG work or doing forensic accounting or running a client accounting services practice or one of those other things that are not the typical kind of compliance work. So I think there's more firms looking at those types of solutions. One, because it's stickier with clients. To be able to do that. You know, obviously the challenge is that with some of those the things I just mentioned, especially on the pure consulting side, it's less annuity work. So people are a little bit afraid of that, but I think that the balance can work out from a firm revenue standpoint. I think things like value pricing is another opportunity that more firms are talking about. Again, we're kind of at an inflection point right now. So everything that was talked about before is, you know, maybe being acted upon a little bit differently than in the past. So value billing and value pricing. And, you know, I think about it that if you think about a firm that has a lot of 1040 work or even a lot of 1065 return work, in essence, they're kind of doing value pricing already. Now, what's it going to cost for you to do my return? It's going to cost $1,000. And, you know, I think it's very likely that firms with a big swath of 1040 work are marking up their time rather than marking down their time, like they might do on the audit side. So that exists already. And, you know, we have to think about it a little bit differently. So I think those are a couple of things that are maybe coming out. Again, we're at a point where I think more and more firms are thinking we got to do something different. And another example that I've got a couple of clients right working on right now that they're actually doing it, even though firms have been talking about this forever, is client culling. So again, the labor challenge of having enough people to do the work that you've got is precipitating the need to say, you know, should we really have this client? And it's a matter of you know, the relationship that they have. Are the clients a pain in the neck? Are they rude to our people? Are they doing things on time? And what's our realization? Are they paying on time? And all those kind of things. And for the first time in a long time, firms are actually pulling the list and going through. And, you know, there's still firms that are reticent to do or partners that are reticent to do it. But I'm seeing that actually happen more than it ever has before, where in the past firms have paid lip service to it. And this year, they're doing it more out of necessity than they have in the past.
Yeah, I would agree with you about the need for client culling. You know, there were plenty of really terrible clients that I worked with in public accounting. You know, fortunately, the really bad ones fired us eventually. Mm-hmm. They usually fired us for the wrong reason, but that was okay. You know, we didn't really care. They were gone. And so, you know, but if we could have culled them earlier, or better yet, not engaged them, not let them come on board, that would have been the best. Absolutely.
Yeah. I think I sometimes have these weird thoughts, and I'll share one with you now, that let's put aside the clients that are terrible people and you don't want to work with them, just say that they're too small. There's probably a business opportunity for somebody, some smart person smarter than me out there, who could pick up a lot of business from the clients or from the firms that are trying to cull their clients. So have a different cost structure, have a more efficient way of doing the work, both on the audit side and the tax side, and you know, and set up a referral network and be able to take advantage of the fact that firms are trying to jettison some of their smaller clients. So somebody's probably going to do that. You know, you'll be interviewing somebody next year about somebody who thought about that and, you know, made a go of it on lower margin work, but they made it up in volume.
There is that option, and that's an interesting idea. In my experience, it wasn't always the really small clients who were so awful, but there were some pretty sizable ones that were really challenging to work with. But I do like that idea of establishing a different kind of business model with somebody who can just automate the heck out of it and focus on making it super easy for the clients. You know, forget the relationship, just crank the work out, just get it in and out.
Well, and you know, I think you've got a question about this later on, but the relationship thing, I think, is an aspiration that the industry doesn't always deliver on. And so, you know, I worked with a firm a couple of years ago that had a pretty strong tax practice, and the average partner had about 600 clients.
Wow.
600 clients. So you know, they had decent books of business. You know, and some of them were corporate that they did the 1040 work, but you know, a lot of them were 1040. I challenge anybody to like have a relationship with 600 different people. So you're just by nature going to default to something that's transactional. I don't know. I think it takes some effort to do that, to be able to have relationships and know enough about the business to be able to give them advice and counsel the way that you should. It's tough to do that, but with 600 clients, there's no way that could ever happen.
No, it's pretty tough to do that. You know, if you had 50 clients that you were intimately involved with, then it would be easy. Or even maybe 200 that you were maybe not quite so intimately involved with, but you met with regularly, that would be doable.
Yeah, but 200 is one a day, one a work day.
That is true. That is true. So you would have to plan things out pretty well.
But it's funny because one of the things that Ron Baker wrote about in Time's Up was concierge medical services. I don't know if he talked about that in the presentation that you saw, but some doctors have gone off and said putting together a subscription model was going to be better than spending, you know, 7 minutes on average with each patient and doing 40 patients a day. And you know, you have to make the math work, obviously, but the satisfaction levels and even more importantly, the quality of care was better in the mind of both the physician and their patients under that kind of model than it was versus the typical GP or specialist model where you get 7 minutes and you're done.
I would agree with you there, and I think that there are. That, you know, Ron Baker's book does have some really good ideas for how you can better align the incentives of the client, what the customer, as he calls them, what they care about, and what we can do as a profession.
Well, and he goes off in a good way. He goes off and goes into a lot of detail about a couple of examples of, you know, the value. One of the premises is value, right? And the definition of value is what you pay for what you get. And so many times firms, companies, retailers are always focused on what you pay part of it and not what you get part of it. And so understanding what a customer needs or wants and being able to deliver that using your unique skills is really what that's all about. And so I mean, the other example I've always heard is not in public accounting, but it's in cell phones. So the cost of goods of an Apple iPhone is about the same as it is for a Samsung. But there's an Apple premium that you pay because it's an Apple. And, you know, you can argue about the right. utility of it. I've got both, so I can argue both of those, but that's the intangible that you get. And we forget about that, I mean, I'll give you a great example about, knowing about clients. So years ago, we instituted a client satisfaction program for one of my firm clients. And we did 50 one-on-one interviews with clients. And the hardest part of this whole thing was like the logistics of setting up the meetings. But we did it over the course of the summer. And we would spend half the time talking about how did we do. And ask them specific questions. And at the end of that, we would get a net promoter score. How likely would you be to recommend? We aggregated all those 50 with the other ones that we did electronically and got a number. It was actually pretty good. But then the second half of this meeting, and the meetings typically took place with the partner, with me as an independent third party, and with the business owner. You know, a lot of times they were smaller, closely held companies. This first half, we're talking about how do we do on the accounting stuff. And they, you know, have a good conversation. But then I would ask them questions about their business, and we're talking about growth or expansion or people issues that they're having. And these business owners would sit on the edge of their seat, and they'd get up and they'd write on the whiteboard and they'd get all excited about it because it was like their baby. And it was remarkable to me how many things that the firm learned in those course of those conversations that we had no idea about because we never asked the damn question. Like, oh, you're going to open up a new plant in this market, or you're planning to sell in a couple of years, or whatever. And because we didn't have those conversations with them, and it was remarkable. I mean, almost every time, maybe 80% of the time, we found out something that we probably should have known ahead of time or known about already.
Yeah, I've talked to other people, notably Al Anderson, who works over in the audit side, about the importance of really asking clients what they care about and about their business, because they frequently are never asked to talk about their business. But if you can ask them, now, what are your struggles? What are your challenges? What are your triumphs? What is your goal? What is your succession plan? When are you planning to sell? Is that in 5 years, 10 years, never? Any one of those questions could lead to just incredible insights, not only about the customer but and the client, but also other things that you could do for this client to help them get where they want to go.
And even that whole process of doing that is a great new business technique where, you know, the typical Q&A will be, okay, can we see last year's tax return and blah, 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 which is obviously what they're paying you for, right? But think about if you were a firm that asked those questions about what's your succession plan or what's your exit plan? Because there is a direct implication of that to your tax planning. What a differentiator that would be, and what a refreshing conversation that would be for that business owner. And they'd probably be hard, unless your fees were crazy, they'd probably be hard pressed not to hire you if you could have that level of conversation rather than just the compliance part of it. And I think that the challenge is that because of the way that God created CPAs, they feel like they have to know all the answers because they do know all the answers for the band in which they have their expertise, or most of them at least. And it's not in their comfort zone to be able to ask questions that they don't know the answer to themselves.
That's right.
And that's never... because I'm not a CPA. That's never scared me. And in fact, it's more for me personally, it's more interesting like that. I'm learning something new and I'll ask anything because and that's how I absorb knowledge over the course of my career. And it's made it interesting for me. I personally like that. And I would invite anybody who wants to differentiate themselves as a CPA in today's market to maybe try to take that same kind of tact about ask open-ended questions that you don't know the answer to. And it'll be remarkable about one, how differentiated you are than most other people, and two, the answer may surprise you and delight the person you're asking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've heard that from so many other people. You know, learn to ask better questions. There is an art to it, and you need to, and it takes practice, but you can do it.
Yeah. Or even like some of the sales books that I've read over the years, it's like, if you go into somebody's office, you kind of do the scan and see what kind of things are displayed, or what kind of books they have on their shelves, or whatever that. So years ago, when I had my first date with my wife, my now wife, I picked her up, and, you know, she's getting ready, and I'm in the living room, and I'm looking at her, on her bookshelf, and we had like three or four of the same books. It's like, okay, that's probably a good sign. And 27 mm-hmm. years later, I think it all proved out.
That's a good idea. You know, I'm not sure how you would apply that to your clients, but just asking them things about what they care about can really open doors.
Yeah. Or like even with clients, like I'll see, oh, you read Good to Great, or somebody has another book that have something else on their shelves. Oh, I read that too. Or like the Ron Baker thing just now with you and me, or that's just mm-hmm. like a kind of a bonding experience that we have we've had that same exposure. And that gives us an opportunity to talk about something that we have in common.
This is true. So listen up, accountants, it's easier than you think. Now, what about growth? You know, there's a lot of talk about growth, and I just kind of wonder, do firms even really need to grow?
So, yes, but you have to take that with a grain of salt, because I'm fundamentally a sales and marketing guy. But here's something to think about. What we never think about, or firms rarely think about, is there's always going to be attrition. So you're going to lose clients because the company gets mm-hmm. sold, or the owner gets mad at you, or whatever. And you know, I've seen numbers like from 5% to 10% where firms will, smart firms will bake that into their modeling for the future year. The other thing is too, and this is a recent example. It happened about a year ago. We were sitting in the partner meeting with a small, very successful firm, and it's primarily tax. And they said, okay, we had a great year in 21. We closed at 6% ahead of where we were in the year before. And I said, didn't you guys just give everyone a raise at the beginning of this year? Mm-hmm. I said, yeah. And how much was that on average? About 8%. So your labor cost, which is about 40% of what your total cost is, it went up 8%, and your growth only went up 6%. So you're not as smart as you think you are. And it's like, oh yeah, we should have thought about that. So I think it's always important. Again, I'm kind of biased that way, but so when you've got attrition, and two, it does allow firms, if they manage it right, to make investments in people, in technology, in acquisitions, or whatever else that they want or need to do. So the question is, and I was going to bring this up later, but I'll do it now, are you familiar with the concept of a lifestyle firm?
Uh-huh. Oh, yes.
Where people, the partners, make good compensation. They don't want to rock the boat. They work hard during busy season, but the rest of the time, maybe not want to do that. And it's kind of working for them, right? They don't want to rock the boat. And I think in those firms, growth is maybe a nice to have, but not a mandatory. And again, I get the reality of, I don't have enough people to do the work that I've got. I've got one client where a couple of the partners are like, we don't want to get any more business this year because we have hard enough time doing the business that we got right now. And I get that. I mean, I don't have to live right in the trenches like they do. But over time, that's not a good strategy. I mean, every firm, I think about this, I was getting ready for our conversation. Of the firms that I work with, this is not a weighted average, but it's just an average. They grew by about 10%, no, about 12% in 2021, ranging from about 30% to about 8% among the spectrum of firms. And some of the ones at the bigger end of the spectrum were picking up larger clients. They had a comparatively small base that they were working from, but all of them grew. So the challenge is now in 2023, how are we going to do the work that we got already? But I think it's important to do that. The other factor, I think, in terms of growth is not getting stuck. I mean, whenever you pick up new clients or new assignments, you learn something new if you're paying attention. And I think if you get in a rut of having the same thing year in and year out, the drudgery factor or the boredom factor is going to set in for the partners, for the managers, for the staff, and all the way down. So it's like the same old, if you ate the same breakfast every day, and it wouldn't be very interesting, I think. So that chain, and again, I'm more predisposed that way personally, but I think having something different is an opportunity to learn in every instance from every client. And then if you're good about it, you can apply that in other places. So I think that, and then also, this also ties back to the idea of opportunities for younger people, because if you are more of a senior level partner and you're grooming somebody to come up in the ranks either from a senior manager to a principal or a principal to a partner, having the ability to have a book that you can hand off to people is kind of how most firms do it. And unless you're growing, that the math doesn't work as easily. And also I think it, and this is a little bit, it's very intangible, but the fact that, most business still comes from referrals. It's referrals from current mm-hmm. clients and referrals from people that you know out of the marketplace. And that's always going to be the case. I mean, I know digital is certainly more important than it's ever been before. And, we can argue about a lot of the different marketing tactics, but at the end of the day, it's always referrals. And the ability to be active and stay active is important. And I think when you're out in the market and growing and viable, it kind of plays on itself. I mean, I had a firm, when I first started working with them, they were about $30 million. And 3 years later, or 4 years later, they were at $50 million and got bought out by a big national firm. And we were able to create a buzz, and it wasn't like we did a big splashy advertising campaign. It was, we were consistently out in the marketplace working with referral sources, being part of industry groups and all those other tactics that we did. And just, it fed upon itself and it became fun. And it became a little bit of competition between the different industry groups and all that. So I think that's invigorating, and it gets you out of the drudgery of it. Having said all that stuff, we were talking about the net promoter score earlier, is that one of the ways if referral sources, including clients, are important to growth, a lot of the ways that firms have neglected to leverage that is by not, like we were talking about a minute ago, not knowing a lot about their clients, not being that that go-to person for the client, so forth. One of the most amazing statistics that I've seen is, we were talking about Net Promoter Score earlier, and for companies that are highly regarded in their industry. So I was going to use the example of Southwest Airlines, but until last week, literally I haven't written down in my notes here, but given the past week, notwithstanding, or Google or Amazon or Starbucks, all of those types of companies get net promoter scores in the 70s, low 70s, mid 70s, really good. And the average, the last data that I saw was from a couple of years ago, but the average for the CPA firm industry is 24. So like that's like in the territory that cable companies get. So nobody likes cable companies. And that just indicates to me that firms are not being proactive, firms are not doing a good job of communications, firms are not learning about the client's business in a way that can they can meaningfully add to it other than from the compliance stuff. So that bar is in Baker's book, that was kind of one of the premises too about value mm-hmm. and what are you really doing and what do you stand for. So all these things are kind of interrelated, but it really does matter. It really does indicate to me is like if a firm can make a conscious effort to determine how they can serve their clients better besides just filling out their return and having it done by April 15th, and understanding what the needs are that does of their clients, it does solve a number of different problems of client retention, client growth, challenging your people, and all of that. So I think that's another piece of it that you've got to get out of that pure compliance mindset and figure out, as Baker said, you know, what is the value that you're really providing? And, you know, and I've had those conversations with some partners at some firms, and the answers that I've gotten so far are kind of lousy. They're just not compelling. So I think that's an opportunity for firms to differentiate themselves.
Now, since you're a sales and marketing guy, do you suggest different strategies for growth to itty-bitty firms and to big firms? I'm curious. Or is it kind of the same?
It's funny. I've worked with or worked for everything from one of the big four firms to a $3 million firm. So from a $20 billion to a $3 billion. And it's all the same. The number of zeros on everything is different, but the approach is similar. So the people that excel and are good at what they do and their clients value them have those characteristics of being technically competent or knowing mm-hmm. or having enough or little of an ego that they can bring in people that might know the answer even if they don't, to understand the client's business, and to encourage and inspire their people that work with them to do the same and to embrace that client relationship. I think that's exactly whether you're doing the audit for you know Fortune 10 or whether you're doing the audit for you know some little retail store or that's got a bank loan in your neighborhood.
Well, it sounds like all these strategies are just things that accounting firms should be doing as it is.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's like, so again, we're in the throes of finishing up a lot of planning sessions for 2023. And what I always say this at the beginning of the sessions with firms, it's like, what are you really committed to doing? Because everyone, we can write a great plan. Everyone's singing Kumbaya at the end of it, and it's all mm-hmm. great. And then in about a month from right now, everyone's going to be in busy season, starting getting into busy season. Mm-hmm. Any notion of anything we talked about is out the door. And so I advise them, it's like, if you're really committed to this, then we got to have a more specific plan and have people actually responsible for it and actually talk about it even during busy season, God forbid, and have specific tactics, timing, and KPIs that you look at. It's funny because my observation has been that a lot of CPAs are really good about a process of what they do, how they deliver the work for their clients, whether it's an audit or a tax, taxes or even a consulting engagement. And when it comes to running their firms, it's like, yeah, maybe. What do you think? What do you think the revenue is going to be? Oh, about what it was last year, and maybe 6%. It's like, you know, hope is not a strategy. And having a vision and having the guts to execute on it and the infrastructure to be able to execute on it, I think is super important. And, you know, as firms get bigger and have a little bit more infrastructure, like, you know, in HR or in marketing or finance or IT, if you have the right people on the bus, you know, to quote that old phrase, those are the people, the professionals that could actually help you do that, help you run the firm,
right,
and not have the partners or just the managing partner be that funnel through which every decision has to be made. And you know, yeah, it costs money to do that, but it's also an opportunity cost. So if you've got a smart person that could run a firm, that can help run the firm in their area of expertise in HR, let's say, you know, use them instead of having it be an administrative. I hate it when firms talk about the admin department, because that says automatically it's they're just overhead. I had one firm I worked for, the CEO, new CEO came in and said, we're not going to call them any of that anymore. We're going to call them strategic services, because that's what they're offering. And you know, and I think there's a firm in Arizona where the growth person, the marketing person, became the managing partner. You know, first of all, they made him a partner, and then they made him the managing partner. It's like, oh my God, how mind blowing is that?
That's pretty different. That's very different.
And they're doing things like value pricing, and they're looking at succession, and they're having conversations with their clients. And so having someone that has a different business sense than a CPA is unique. But again, I think you, as a firm gets bigger, investing in those kind of people that can help you run the, if you're a managing partner, help you run the firm and think about some of those things, because it's all about growth and it's all about people. So the two most important folks on the team should be that chief revenue officer, marketing person, salesperson, whatever you want to call them, and your HR person or whatever you want to call them. Mm-hmm. I mean, and if you don't have that strong, all you're going to be doing is executing a bunch of tactics.
Right. You know, and I was talking to my husband today about there are many firms who pay for expensive coaching and expensive mentoring, but much of their ideas, you know, it's like a kumbaya moment. You know, they give lip service during the meeting. Oh yeah, that's a great idea. And then they file that away. None of it really works into the culture. And that, you know, unless they're willing to change their culture, nothing is going to change.
Or unless they have a process for executing things and making it really stick. I mean, one of the things that I do with my clients, and I get really entrenched with what they do, is I've never, ever since I started my firm, I've never had a client that I just left and said, here's the plan, go have a nice day. I forgot who it was, some CEO of some big company. The urban legend was that he left a copy of their business plan on an airplane by accident. And he wasn't worried about it, because he said, you know, it's all about the execution. I could write anything I want to in the business plan, but unless you got the right people and process and coaching and all that kind of stuff to be able to make it happen, it doesn't matter. I think that goes true for planning and strategic planning as well, of having somebody in charge of making sure that it's all happening. Otherwise, again, you wake up at the end of the year and it's like, yeah, we talked about doing that. We never did.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. You know, and any kind of change management, you've got to have somebody who's really pushing that change. Mm-hmm. And too often I've had the experience that, well, you know, we got this great training by XYZ company, but beyond adding maybe a sheet to the performance review for this 1 year, we're not going to change at all. So right. Why? Now,
let me ask you a question. So do you think... Mm-hmm. Do you think it'd be easier, or would it be easier to start a firm from scratch that had all of these grand notions that we've been talking about, versus changing a firm from the inside?
I think it depends on the individuals involved. You know, if you come in, if you have a pretty well established firm where everybody is used to doing things the way that they've been doing them for a long time, it might be really hard to come in as the new sheriff in town and say, no, we're going to be doing things a different way from now on. That might be really challenging. But if you have a firm of young people who are threatening to mutiny or leave for better pastures, then they may very well welcome a new way to do their jobs and to function within an organization. So I think it really depends on the firm and how invested everyone is in the status quo.
So I've got examples on both sides. So on the traditional firm side, I can think of firms like Aprio in Atlanta or Armamino on the West Coast, where there were both old line firms that had been around for a long time. I think if I'm correct, Armamino was like a family owned firm, and the second generation of Armaminos took it over and, you know, set the market on its ear in a good way by investing in technology and people and processes and building out their consulting practice and doing all that. I give them a lot of credit because it would have been easy just to kind of keep the status quo. And the same thing with Aprio. I think Richard Koppelman is a great example of taking an old line firm and renaming it, rebranding it with a way different name that wasn't a bunch of old dead white guys like most firms are. So I think those are examples, but they you know, had a lot of struggles, I'm sure, along the way to be able to do that. Now, on the other hand, you've got smaller kind of startup firms like Dark Horse CPAs that's on the on the tax side, where Chase is trying to do things in a very different way, or Audit Club, where Chris Vanover is trying to do the same sort of thing on the audit side and rework the model. And I don't know which is easier, because I think there's probably struggles with either model, but it just seems like if you could start from scratch and hire the right people and grow it, when we've got all this disruption in the market right now, you know, now might actually be the right time to do that.
I think you could be right. You know, the challenge might be that if you hire people who have been in public accounting for any time, they may be uncomfortable with the switch to a new kind of way of operating, and they may really push to go back to the status quo. So it's difficult all around.
And I think the data that I saw recently was the average managing partner was a little bit different for different size firms, but I think the youngest average, depending on which tranche you were looking at, was like 56 years old. And so, for the smaller firms, it was like 62 or 63 years old, and you know they ain't gonna change. It's like it's working, and maybe they shouldn't, because it's been working for them. And if they can figure out how to get out of Dodge, it's like you can ride off into the sunset and be fine without going through all that painful change. But the problem, the market is that if that's the case, I just wrote about this in CPA Trendlines, and I wrote an article about succession planning or successions in firms, that in the next couple of years, the last baby boomer is going to reach retirement age. And so you've got the pig and the python going out. And so if a lot of these smaller firms are owned by individuals that are of that age, they're going to have a whole bunch of more of those firms come on the market at the same time. And you know, that multiple that firms have been getting in the past may not be the same case with this, that whole supply and demand thing.
Exactly right. And, you know, somebody new who's, you know, in their 30s or maybe 40s looking to buy a firm might not be very interested in buying a legacy firm if they see that everything will have to be changed from the ground up.
Mm-hmm. And obviously you've got the fact that you have clients makes things a little bit easier, so you don't have to build that from scratch. But again, with the tumult that's happening in the market right now, like we were talking about earlier, more and more clients are looking for firms. And, you know, if you could put together a different value proposition that again, wouldn't be hard to do or to execute on, I think a young person could do that. Now, I think the next 5 years could be the time to do that.
That's right. Well, at any rate, accountants are going to have to pick up some new skills. You know, it used to be that to be good in accounting, you had to be great with a 10 key. But, you know, young accountants these days, they don't even know what a 10 key is. So what are the skills that accountants need to be successful today and in the future?
I think it comes down to one thing, and it's the why of the numbers, not just the numbers, but the why of the numbers, because people have written about this and spoken about this in the past, that accounting is of looking back. You're looking back at last year's revenue and doing your tax return. You're looking back at last year's revenue and you're doing your audit. And, you know, maybe with the exception of consulting, which tends to be a little bit more forward looking, that's what we do for the most part. And we don't get into the why this happened. And so, you know, and the closest that I've seen come recently is with client accounting services, where firms are realizing, you know what, we've got all the information in real time for our client company how the sausage is made and where they make money and all of that. And I think delving into that and becoming a better expert about helping the clients run their business why these are happening. And so in client accounting services, where firms are saying, you know, we can do dashboarding for them. I think the smart firms are trying to do that. So that's one part too. So it's not just the report of, hey, your margin was this or your cost of goods is that, but rather, so what? The answer to the question, so what? And what do you do with that information? And again, if you're doing it for enough different clients, especially if you've got an industry expertise, it becomes easier because the patterns are going to be similar. You know, and every company is going to be a little bit different. But again, you have that embedded knowledge, and you know the ability to take that body of experience that you have with other clients and say, I don't know if this will work with you, but here's what I've seen before, and to be able to have an informed conversation about that, it would be so powerful because, you know, who else? I guess there are other people, but who else would or could a client turn to be able to get that broad view that CPA firms could be offering? So the short answer is understanding the why of the numbers and being able to explain that in a meaningful way with clients.
That is so important, you know, and that's not something that we get taught in CPA school.
There
was like one little chapter in one of my books that went into the ratios, and never again, you know, pull it up and we never used it again. And, you know, it would have been so powerful if we could have just kept sort of a running dashboard of our clients by industry of different ratios and different KPIs, and use that in ways to give them advice on how to improve things or just benchmark them. You know, I mean, even, you know, benchmarking isn't that useful because it's just looking at the past, but you know, at least that could have been something more than just, here's your tax return, Mr. Client.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just something.
Again, and having the ability and the desire to have those kind of conversations. So that's again, what makes it interesting for your people. It makes you more of an expert for them and more invaluable to your client. And it gives a value that most other firms aren't even doing.
No, or couldn't do. No. Yeah. Now, we've talked about things that accountants should do. What are some things that accountants should stop doing immediately?
Treating their people like chattel or cattle, depending on mm-hmm. where. I mean, again, we talked earlier about compensation, and that model is broken, and it's only going to be more ugly in the next couple of years. And so it's partially, part of it's compensation, part of it is that human factor of taking these smart people, finding out what their strengths are, and being able to create an environment in which they can thrive with those strengths. And again, not everyone's created equally, but spending the time with individuals to understand what their potential is. And it sounds all airy-fairy, but at the end of the day, isn't that what everyone wants? You know, they want some sort of satisfaction for what they do. We spend a lot of time at the office. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if there's not some purpose to it, then why the hell bother?
Yeah, we need some feeling of connection to what we're doing. And just treating people like individuals instead of just means to get the work done would help a lot.
I have one client that is a very diverse firm. So they're about 70% diverse. And rather than, and they've used that as a selling point because the notion is, you know, out of many ideas comes good ideas. And so people have different viewpoints because they grew up differently or didn't grow up in the United States or grew up in a different part of the country or whatever else. And rather than fighting that and being, you know, defensive about it, they've embraced it. And I think it does make for better people in a better environment. Like at their Thanksgiving dinner, everyone brings things from their native country, and I couldn't even begin to describe some of the weird, or not weird, some of the very different things that do not appear on normal Thanksgiving tables in most American households. But they embrace that. And that's kind of their claim to fame, where people can fit in. You know, so whether it's first generation Americans or first generation college graduates, or you know, people who just learned English or whatever else, it's a really cool environment where people have come together and, you know, they speak, I think my last count, there's like 19 different languages that people speak there. You know, they had some client that had some document that came in and it's like, anybody speak Portuguese? Do we have anybody that speaks Portuguese? And it's like, oh yeah, she does.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, but they've embraced that and they've made that part of the culture of the firm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you know, it comes down to culture. You know, we've got to adapt. You know, it's a changing demographic here in the US, and it's not going to be old white guys running things forever.
Mm-hmm. You know, I'm sitting right here, right?
Yeah, I know. I know you are, but, you know, I know from hearing you talk about diversity that's something that you're not frightened of.
No, I'm not.
So, now, what are the things that keep accountants from changing? What are some of the blocks?
I think it starts with the notion of the lifestyle firm, like it's working for me. I'm making good compensation. I'm a pillar of the community. I got a good parking spot, and that is I've got the brass ring, and I think that's like why upset the apple cart, and I get that. I mean, I've been a shareholder in two different organizations before, and I get that, and I know you know conversations I've had with other people I work with is like, well, one, they think that that's never going to happen for them because for whatever reason. And two, it doesn't from a statistical standpoint. I forgot what the number is, but like the chances of somebody who comes into a CPA, to a big four firm as a staff, you know, how many out of 100, how many wind up becoming a partner? I don't know what the number is, but I'm sure it's
less,
single digits.
Less than one.
Yeah.
I would bet.
It's probably right. So the fact that it's worked for them personally and professionally, it's like, why would I want to go through, you know, oh my God, this whole value pricing idea? What a, I'm going to have to keep track of change orders and go back to my client and ask him about this and all that. I'm not going to do that.
Or figure out a subscription model. And what is this?
Subscription? Yeah. What's that? We're not a magazine. We're a CPA firm.
We're not Amazon.
Yeah. But it's funny. I'm getting ready for a meeting next week. Funny you mentioned Amazon. And one of the opening conversations we're going to have is on the slide I've got is a picture of Amazon logo and the Whole Foods logo. And the slide says, what would Amazon do? So if Amazon decided to get into the CPA firm business, the accounting firm business, what would they do? Like,
they would buy one.
And then what would they do to it or with it?
They would make it like a subscription. They would have memberships. They'd have tiers of service. They would make it easier to interact with.
They do balance billing where they say, okay, we're not going to charge you $60,000 over the course of 2 months to do your audit. We're going to break it out into $5,000 a month to help you with your cash flow or whatever else they're going to do. That's funny because it'll be interesting to see what happens next week when you have that conversation with, like, once people get their heads around that. And they're obviously they're really smart people, but what ideas might come out of that? In that Ron Baker book, he talks about Richard Branson asking the question, mm-hmm. you know, what are the 10 things what are the 10 things that you should be asking your customers or something like that? Mm-hmm. That kind of opens up that thought. Back to your question, the notion of the lifestyle firm combined with the demographics of I'm a 55-year-old guy, gal, and it's worked for me. Why would I want to change anything? And I'm in charge and I know everything. I know better than anybody else. There's still some of that mentality, whether it's overt or not. And I think that's the biggest impediment.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's always worked this way.
Yeah. Why change?
Why? And I'm not sure. I guess the answer is why? Because it's not sustainable. And then that partner, and I've literally had this conversation before with, you know, partners that are in their early 60s. It's like, you know what? I only got a couple more years left. I'm not going to worry mm-hmm. about it. And it's like, I get that.
That's okay if there are other partners who are younger who are willing to push those changes through.
Mm-hmm.
But if this is a solo practice, then they may have a hard time finding a good buyer. And they may have a hard time finding a buyer who is going to treat their clients just the way that they did. And their people. They may have a very hard time with that.
I mean, we had a firm years ago that we bought. So the mothership firm was about $40 million, and the firm that we bought was probably they're probably $5 million or so. All and they were all taxed, three partners, and they were like making really good money, and they had a good client base, and blah 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 blah. And I was talking to one of them after the deal was signed. I said, "What would you have done if you didn't sell to this firm?" No, we probably would have shut it down. Like we've made money over time. Like didn't want to go through the whole, you know, process of turning. We didn't have anybody to turn it over to. Probably would have just shut it down. Like, oh, okay. So, I mean, instead they sold it and made boodles of money, and one of the partners stayed on and made even more boodles of money. But I'm sure that thought goes through the minds of some of these small firms. It's like, I'm just going to shut it down. I've got enough in my retirement nest egg. I don't have anybody to turn it over to. Because firms do a lousy job of internal succession planning. And so I think that's back to our idea, the idea of that small firm that takes the business from all these other smaller firms. There is going to be a market for that, where there's no succession planning, there's no no market for it really, that a big firm like a big four firm is not going to, or a big regional is not going to buy a $2 million firm in Poughkeepsie. So what's going to happen to them? What would Amazon do?
they would probably try to find a buyer or cut their losses, you know. I mean, the other extreme is that if you don't plan and you don't have a plan for selling, then what happens if you God forbid, drop dead of a heart attack? I've seen that happen to a few solo firms in my area. And, you know, what happens to the clients after that? It's terrible. They're kind of stuck.
Yeah. But, you know, there is thinking about the small firms, BDO in Canada has got like 100 offices.
Wow.
100 offices. So, and, you know, in Canada, population in Canada is 30 million. It's like the size of Texas. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't know what percentage are in the big cities, but I'm sure that most of it. So they're in, you know, Whitefish or some of these little towns, right. White Arrow, Yellow Arrow or Whitefish, right. Or whatever. But they make a go of it in these smaller markets because, these small and medium sized businesses are kind of the backbone of the economy, whether it's the Canadian or the US economy. And if they can get, you know, high level attention and good service and from sophisticated people, it's like they need it as well as if somebody was in Vancouver.
That's very true. Very true. Well, to tie up this conversation, I'm going to ask you to get out your crystal ball,
okay,
and predict what you think the next big thing in accounting will be.
So I've got a broad answer for this. And so you may want to pin me down a little bit more. I think the idea of going more into more of the consulting business is going to be the difference. Again, so some of the themes that we're talking about before, it takes the people that you've got that have a specific skill set, whether it's in audit or tax, and being able to reapply it in a different, more interesting way. Right. It's a way of creating greater value for companies. And I think about the typical firm and the typical small, medium-sized business that they work with. It's like they still have the small businesses have fewer internal resources to be able to figure this stuff out, because usually it's a sole proprietor, they need more help than a big company that can afford to hire consultants or people with experience or whatever else. So that middle market, which again is sort of the backbone of the economy, needs adult supervision more than anybody else. Mm-hmm. And that adult supervision is more than just doing their tax returns or doing an audit if they need that. It's like running their business. And there is no, as far as I know, I haven't come across any type of company that or firm that can offer that omnibus look at how to run your business better. It's like if all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. So if I'm a manufacturing expert of improving what goes on the floor, that's one thing. But I could be a human capital person and help on that. But there's no one. So it's like a game of whack-a-mole, right? But if you had an organization that was specifically tailored to helping small and medium enterprises grow, I think you've got, as an industry, we have the doors open already because we've got credibility and objectivity. but do we have the ability to actually add value, kind of like what we were talking about before? And I think that's a big differentiator. And then I think there's also some kind of bridge areas, whether it's ESG, which is, you know, still audit in some regards, or some of the financial planning and wealth management where firms are getting into. I mean, baby boomers are still retiring, and that whole transfer of wealth is going to be the largest transfer of wealth in human history. And trying to figure all that stuff out is still an opportunity. So I'm seeing more firms getting into that. And it's funny because they got into it years ago and then got out of it, and it seems like they're getting back into it again. So I think those are two. But I think the consulting for middle market companies is the one thing. And that's probably not a 2023 thing. It's a, you know, next 5 years thing.
Mm-hmm. You know, well, there are firms that are doing like outsourced CFO work. So that's kind of close to that.
It's kind of close.
But that's just the CFO that isn't looking at the whole entirety, that isn't helping them with their marketing. It's not helping them with their HR and their hiring and their compliance with all the labor laws. It's not everything.
So maybe the better piece is outsource COO. Because yeah. I mean, think about the average SME and somebody who started a company, had a good idea, and they were good at something, making widgets or selling services or whatever it was. And, you know, as companies get bigger, it gets harder for them to spin all the plates at the same time. There's a thing I remember from management school called the Griner curve, G-R-E-I-N-E-R, not to be confused with Brittany Griner. And it's about the challenges that companies have as they grow. And it's less about the dollar volume and more about the number of employees. And they're the crises that occur, and I'll get it wrong, it's like crisis of communications, the collaboration, and there's like another C. And think about it, like if you're the owner of the company, you started the company and you start hiring a bunch more people, the organization is accustomed to going through you to get all the decisions made. And if everyone's coming to me as the owner to get all the decisions made, it's like you can't just physically can't communicate with that many different people. Your inbox gets backed up. And then as you get bigger, it's a collaboration where you tend to have silos, where I've got this person doing this and this person doing this and this person doing this. And then there's another C that happens. So I think having a chief operating officer service that could help that small business avoid those challenges on the Griner curve would be an interesting solution.
That's a really interesting idea. And it just happens that I'm working with a tech firm that builds accounting technology for, you know, all kinds of companies. And one project I'm working with them on is trying to encourage controllers to step into more of an operational role. You know, not the cost accounting kind of viewpoint, but operations, optimizing, iterating, making things better, putting in processes, figuring out where all the bottlenecks are and fixing them. And so controllers are the logical choice because they already touch just about every part of the business. So if we could bring back controllers from industry and have them add their genius to public accounting firms, they could do something fantastic.
See, we need to talk offline. We come up with two new business ideas here. we're giving it away to free to everyone who reads or subscribes to CPA Trendlines.
That's right. But, you know, lots of people will hear this, but not very many people will take us up on the offer.
It's like leaving your business plan on the airplane. It doesn't matter. It's all about execution.
That's exactly right. Yeah. Well, I think that's probably a good place to wrap things up. I want to thank you so much, Bill, for taking the time to talk to me. Now, if listeners want to connect with you, where's the best way to find you?
They could go to CPA Trendlines and just Google Bill Penczak, P-E-N-C-Z-A-K. And my contact information is there. I'm a regular contributor there. Or you can go to my website, which is www.mica.ventures. So it's no.com.ventures. Yes, that is a real URL. And my contact information is there as well. And
All right. Well, thank you so much. And you have a great rest of your day.
Okay. Thanks, Liz. I appreciate it.
Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of CPATrendlines.com, now available on iTunes. We hope you'll rate and review us wherever you find your podcasts to help other accountants find our show more easily. For more information, you can go to CPATrendlines.com.